guys our discussion. Okay, Mahmoud, two key questions. What's the character of party elections in the current time? And also, how is it different from previous elections? Perhaps key observations. The party is, in the 2016 elections, still fragmented, just like the previous ones. Previous elections, be it 2004, 2007, 2015. And second, it seems that the continuity or change narrative in the presidential election, I think some of you might question, might contest this, but if you look at the presidential campaign now, the seeming dominant narrative is, should we continue with the Anwar to win or should we change? And so I adopted it also. And that kind of narrative does not seem to excite campaign for the party list if you compare it to 2010, for example. In 2010, there were a lot of tandem TV ads that you see. So after the ad of the presidential candidate, then for 5 seconds you would see Akbayan or General Bago, Generacion, etc. It's called tandem TV ads. Now, there's not much of it. So what we see here would be, while the numbers are a bit erratic, was so from 162, 66, then 93, 150, 79, and now there are 185 of them. So it's a little bit erratic, but we can argue that there's an increasing number of contenders, participants into the parties every time. So it was, for 2016, it's a peak of participation. So except for 2007 elections, the number of winning contenders is also increasing. So you can see that 2007, there is 14. Also because at the time, there were some controversies, and there were cases that were filed in the Supreme Court that remained unresolved. And later on, it was resolved, then there were some changes again on the formula of how to allocate the seats, etc. And of course, the latest would be 2013, that have done away with the 2% requirement. And it allotted 20% in the House of Representatives membership has not been consumed yet by the top vote getters. That would be distributed to the other parties based on their own votes, the so-called Hare formula. So, since 2011, 20% has been maximized as a participation of the parties in the House of Representatives. Okay, so taking a focus on the 2016 groups, I just made a cursory grouping. Others would have some other kind of segmentation. But this is just based, cursory because it's just based on the registered name. Perhaps a more deeper kind of segmentation would look at the profile of each and every party list, then try to group them where they belong. So simply, consumer and single advocacy groups, just like those from the electricity sector, for example. Would you believe that the rural electricity groups also have a party list? That's one example there. For professionals, there are a lot of nurses who seem to be marginalized, even scientists, again, for example. Former policemen, or Magdalo kind of, they're also there. So I just classified it under the professional because if you look at the membership later on, they're professional groups. Also, the seamen are there. There are three seamen groups in the party list, for example. UNCLASS 1, you could easily see the tarpaulin over there in Quirino Avenue, number 43. I just saw it when I passed by. And in transportation group, also, they have five. One Utak is the most dominant. Then the marginalized sector. I just grouped the marginalized sector, meaning women. I separated Kabataan party list as a left party. So women, the PWDs, then there, farmers, fisher folk, etc. For the entrepreneur and business, like the sort of LPG and A, for example. So, those small retailers of LPG and there. So yun yung mga nandyan sa list. At saka yung mga kasangga, they're promoting small scale enterprises. And then the indigenous people and regional groups. Regional groups would refer to Amin or Anak Mindanao or Anwaray. Those based on ethnic or geographical locations. So I just put them there. And then the left part of this, will be later explained. These are the ones that are would trace their roots to the national democratic tradition. So there are about 10 of them. So that's the total. So there are about 10 of them. So that's the total. And then, of course, that's the explanation. So, professional group, teachers. A lot of teachers grouping Manila teacher, A teacher, AM teacher, some nurses as well, retirees, the ex-policemen and ex-rebels, for example. Then, marginalized sectors. And so, some observations. Yeah, the Supreme Court decision in 2012 is a liberal interpretation of the party list law, RA 7941. What it tried to do was to be true to the discussions in the commission on the drafters of the constitution, where they wanted to have a twin objective of representation for the marginalized, but they also wanted as an objective the development of pro-Buhangin parties. So, for the, some people, they say that why are nurses marginalized? Or why are seamen who earn 200,000 a month or 500,000 a month would be marginalized and they have their dwellings? But also because the law allows groups and sectors just come together, have an advocacy of their own, promote that, their own programs, and it will be allowed in that part. And the Supreme Court decision will acknowledge. So, hopefully that kind of grouping will help in developing groups or sectors to come up with programs and platforms that are similar. And the expectation, of course, if you're a seaman, you're a group of mariners, an club, for example, our expectation would be they would advocate, once they're in Congress, for their own sectoral or group interests. But of course, if you will make an assessment of the current members of the House of Representatives coming from the parties, you can easily say that perhaps that's not the case. Again, we will context ourselves that legislation itself is a negotiation. And sometimes you need to be open to and have some that keep pro also that your own interest will also given its own time. Also, that the same Supreme Court decision facilitated the entry of parties and groups identified with political families and groups. Examples of this would be Agbiag. It's a regional party list for Ilocanos. Or before its delisting, Anggalit Pinoy, where we found Mikey Arroyo as the representative, the former President GMA. In fact, in 2007, that marked the entry of party list groups that were identified with traditional political parties, because the strategy then of the GMA administration is to block any attempt to impeach GMA. So the GODAP administration at that time organized up to 12 party list. So that they can, once they will be in Congress, they can, you know, lessen the impact of the noise from the left parties. Because if you remember 2005, 2006, one of the major movers of the impeachments against GMA would be Bayan Muna, Akbayan, those that are identified to them. For 2016, with the sheer number that we had seen, 185 of them, you'd say that there's a fragmentation of parties and groups. Supposedly, these groups can coalesce. They come out, they can have a coalition so that they have a greater chance of winning, and also their program would be more encompassing or inclusive. But then, because of the 230,000 votes, gain equal to one seat, the groups have opted to separate, to fragment themselves and campaign alone and try to get the 230,000 votes. Because under the current the incumbents now, the lowest, which is Ali, had 230,000 votes only, but it was equal to one congressional seat. So that in itself is a disincentive for parties to come together and, you know, bodies and build a bigger and stronger